Okay. Hello, everybody. It's time for our weekly Nakshatra Gods discussion. We're going to be discussing the second half of my new book, Nakshatra, The Authentic Heart of Vedic Astrology. I'll read both bits of it and talk about it and see if you have any questions or reactions or so forth to it. Let me just grab it. There was the daylight savings time change, apparently, huh? All right, so we have today, our topic is the Nagas and their alternative paradise. So remember the story so far, everybody? The story so far is once upon a time, everybody lived together. But one of the really powerful beings in the form of a dragon stole all the water in the world. And then the rain god made some move to liberate the water from that dragon. And after that, he used his victory as a opportunity to replace the king of paradise, the king of the heavens, with himself. So our story ends with Varuna getting exiled from paradise, right? Varuna was relegated to live at the bottom of the sea. Excuse me. And so then what happened? So the first thing that happened is Indra wants to get rid of all Varuna's friends. So remember, part of the politics involved here was Indra was saying, I think Varuna might not be impartial after all, because he's an Asura and Vritra the dragon was an Asura, and that may be why he didn't punish Vritra right away for stealing all the water. So his big claim to fame is that he's totally impartial, but maybe he's not totally impartial after all. So the first thing that Indra wants to do is get rid of all the Asuras. On the plea, like, look what they did. So this is also, basically, you'll find this principle active. Today, it's called racial profiling, or it's called racism. So basically, the Asuras are a race of superhuman beings. The Asuras are a different, slightly different race. And so here, Indra is just categorizing, well, this one Asura did this thing, so all the Asuras must be bad. So that's what he did. So he said, we got to get rid of all the Asuras. No more Asuras allowed to be in paradise. Previous to Indra, the Asuras and the Suras lived together and cooperated in paradise. But after Indra gets it, so this is what politics does. This is even the etymology of the word politics is to create poles. It's to create polarity. April, right? This is what politics does. It creates polarity. It creates polarity. Politics. So what it does is it separates people into groups. Here's these people who believe this way. Here's these other people who believe that way. Here's these people who are like this. Here's these other people who are like that. So that's what Indra did, was he separated Suras and Asuras. And he said, all you guys who are Asuras like Varuna, you also have to go. So what he did was, actually, the rest of the Asuras are not as mellow or broad-minded as Varuna. You'll see this often happens. Usually the Asuras will have a king who's actually quite morally developed, you know, and really is undistinguishable from any Sura. Like Varuna. Very, very morally lofty person. Truly lofty. But it's just kind of like the mafia. I don't know if you guys have ever been involved with the mafia or whatever your local mafia is in your country. But the way those things usually work is that the rank and file people that actually do the dirty work are really dangerous, scummy, thuggy people. But the people that are like the top echelons of the organized crimes are usually actually very cultured. And kind of like they have a lot of principles in their life. So it's the same way with the Asuras. So what happened is that when Indra exiled Varuna, the Nagas and so forth revolted. All the other Asuras revolted. Now, basically, Asuras are Nagas. That's an important thing to know about Nagas and Asuras. Basically, Naga equals Asura. And there's other varieties of Asuras, but basically Naga equals Asura. And remember, Asura means super powerful. Sura means powerful, and Asura means super powerful. And that's the thing about Asuras, is they're a little too powerful. And so they act a little bit more independent. They don't feel the need to cooperate because they're so powerful. So the Asuras revolt, but they don't have Indra. I'm sorry, they don't have Varuna on their side. And Indra's got this thunderbolt now. I don't know. I'll tell you this story at some other point of how he actually, the details of how he got this thunderbolt. But he's got this like super weapon of mass destruction. So he, without much trouble, the gods actually, what do you call it? Evict. So they evicted all the Asuras from Swarga. Now, this is a good point. This is a good time for a little geography lesson, Vedic geography or cosmography. Swarga is up. Now, actually, the Vedic cosmography has the cosmos as a round thing, which is a definite immediate shoot in the heart to all you flat earth people, but who say that the Vedas are flat earth. The cosmography of the Vedas is always round and globular, or some other weird thing that you haven't even considered before, like sometimes conal, like in the shape of a mountain. But the basic shape of the cosmos is globular, like an egg or a bubble. And as we discussed this week in our first Vedic wisdom thing about creation, and there are all these bubbles. So the bubble has three basic zones to it. That circle, that globe, has three basic zones. One is the outer zone, which is called Swarga. And that's where Indra, Varuna, all these guys, all these divinities, they dwell there. That's where the nakshatras are, and the divinities dwell in those nakshatras. So the stars are out there on the outer edge of this circle. Then there's a middle zone called the Antariksha or a Bhuva. And in that zone is where you get these semi-divine, semi-mundane entities. Like the nine grahas, the planetary deities, the sun, literally the sun, the planets, and everybody, they're in a closer space than the stars are. The stars are far away. The Vedic people had the same conception. It's compatible with our modern cosmology, that the stars are really far away, but the planets and the sun are closer. And then you have the core, the middle of this globe thing, which is Bhu, the earth, the place where stuff actually, the place where we exist. So then those are the three basic zones, but you can divide these into 14 instead of three. Sometimes you may have heard about Vedic cosmology having 14 worlds. And these aren't 14 planets, although some translators make it as planet. They're 14 planes, 14 worlds, 14 worlds. A world is not the same as a planet. So there's some, when you divide it into 14, there's actually some that are within the core, within the earth. It's deeper, it's inside the core of the universe. And then there's seven that are above the core and seven that are inside the core. So within Bhu or underneath Bhu, there's other worlds. So what happened? Hey, my aunt, Anita Faye is watching. So what happened is, when Indra evicted all the dragons, the Nagas, from Swarga, the outer part of the universe, they fall. They're falling towards the middle, and there's a gravitational force towards the middle of the universe. So all of these serpents, dragons, everything, are falling out of the sky. And you see this in a lot of human culture. They have this imagery of a serpent falling out of the sky, or a fallen angel or something. So basically the fallen angel motif that you find all over mythology of any culture, it's from this. It's from when the Nagas and Asuras were evicted by Indra. So they fall, and they fall to Boo. They fall to the earth. But what do snakes do? Now think about snakes in everyday life. Snakes go down into the ground. So I'll read you a little bit about this. Let me just see what I got here in the way of a comment. So are Nagas the reptilian conspiracy? So this is interesting because actually, I don't know, reptilian conspiracy is beyond my comprehension, but it is an interesting fact that this is basically the framework of the idea that there's reptiles living in the middle of the earth. But you have, the thing that it has to dawn on your mind is that the way human beings perceive reality is not the way that everybody perceives reality. Bugs, ants, bacteria, they don't perceive reality the same way that you and I do. Dogs, cats even. They have a slightly different perception. Superhuman beings like the Devas, the Nagas, all these, they don't see the earth the same way that you see it. And so the center of this thing that we can measure with our human tools and instruments, it probably is not the same as the Naga Loka where the Nagas dwell. That's one thing that you have to realize. So whether you could take like a big gigantic oil rig and drill down and get into Naga Loka, you probably can't, because Naga Loka isn't anywhere. See, the human beings exist in Bu Loka. It's not a, it's a realm, it's a world. We exist in Bu Loka. No matter if you, how far you drill down or how high you go up, you're always going to be in Bu Loka version of the universe. The Nagas, they exist in Nag Loka. If they want to cross into Bu Loka, they have a way to do that. And humans can also cross into these different realms. There's ways to do that. But it's not done physically through your realm. It's done mystically through the manas, through the mind power. The mind can connect to a projection of itself in a different realm. So it's not like you just dig down into the ground and all of a sudden you're going to find Dungeons and Dragons, full of dragons with treasures and everything. But that's the mythology, because that's how it's visualized. All right, so let me check my YouTube thing. Don't want to be unfair to the YouTubers. I like the comments feed is so much easier on Facebook and everything. Now, Neil Patel says he thinks Arjun once did this. So you got to also know a little bit about how magic works. Magic works with symbolic things. So if you're going to transport yourself to a different realm, you're going to use some sort of symbolic device, like a step or a shovel or something. But trust me, if you just take a shovel without the magic ritual that goes with it, you're not going to get to Naga Loka. Naga is the same as Ardra, right? So we're actually, the stuff that we're talking about now has to do with the Ardra Nakshatra, because the Nagas dwell in Ardra. Okay. Yeah, let me change back to my book and read you a little bit about that. So here we go. With Varuna gone, Indra immediately turned upon the dragons. And he declares, to recompense the crime done by the archetype of your race, I banish you two from paradise. The dragons rose ferociously against Indra, but against the fully prepared might of the gods, they could not prevail and plummeted from heaven's paradise. Landing upon the earthly plane, they tunneled beneath it. And with the help of their great architect and leader and builder, Maya, they created a second paradise in the space below the earthly realm, a subterranean paradise out of sight of the sun and the gods, whom they would forever onward resent and oppose. So this is really interesting. And will be interesting when we get to talk about the Chitra Nakshatra with its god, Tvashta, and how impartial the Chitra Nakshatra is. That it's a couple of the gods were looking at Indra's shenanigans, kind of stroking their chins, saying, I don't really go along with this. And Tvashta is one of them. Tvashta is the creator. So what Tvashta did was he said, I don't think all these asuras are bad. So he made a duplicate of himself and left with the asuras, but kept a duplicate of himself in heaven to help Indra run the place. So that duplicate of Tvashta is called Maya. Maya means magic. Has great magic power. Magic means technology, actually. The ability to accomplish things in amazing ways is magic. So Maya and a couple of other important beings fell down with the serpents, the dragons. When they got down to the earth plane, they said, we're not going to sit here underneath the gods, just where they can look at us all the time and keep track of our every move. Let's go someplace else. So they went into the earth, and that's how snakes have that tendency to burrow into the earth. And when they got down there, again, talking using mythological visualizations to make it concrete in your head, when they got into that space, they excavated it under the guidance of Maya. And what Maya did was, Maya and Tvashta creates the heavens, but Maya creates the alternate heavens. And this is a very important thing about Nagas and Ashlesha. This is it. Ardra? Did I say Ardra before? No, yeah, I made this mistake. Somebody said, is Naga the same as Ardra? Ardra is Rudra. So sorry about that. I didn't catch that. Nagas are Ashlesha. So this is a very important thing to understand. Ashlesha Nakshatra is that it has a lot to do with being alternate. Alternate. So alternative lifestyle. That's very Naga-ish. They get kicked out of one spot and then they say, all right, we'll do something better and different. So Ashlesha Nakshatra has a tendency not to really go mainstream. Not to go mainstream, but to go into underground things. Underground also. See, alternative. Think about all the word alternative in terms of how it's used in pop culture. It also has to do with the term underground. And both of those concepts are associated with Nagas because they go underground and they create an alternative world. They create an alternative paradise down there. So this is the difference between Christian and Vedic concept. Basically, Christian, like a run-of-the-mill Christian concept that I'm familiar with, has a concept of three zones, heaven and earth and hell. And you might think that, well, the Vedic concept also has a concept of three zones, swarga. Well, it's not actually the same, but you might think of it as like there's the earth in the middle and then there's the heavens in the top and then there's some Nagas and snakes like Satan down underneath the earth, so it must be just like the Christian thing, hell. No, it's not. The Naga's place is a place of extreme pleasure. So that's another important thing to understand about Ashlesha. Aslesha, the very word Aslesha means to embrace. So it's a place of great pleasure, a lot of pleasures. It's kind of hedonistic. They're really into pleasures. So they built kind of like a Las Vegas, really. I think whenever I go to Las Vegas or even think about, thankfully, I haven't been to Las Vegas in perhaps a decade. But whenever I remember Las Vegas or whatever, I think, God, this is exactly like Naga Loka. Because it's like in the middle of a desert where nobody would go by choice, but they like masterfully created this alternative reality over there where there's actually almost like no sunshine because you're always inside. You can never tell what time it is. And there's all kind of riches and wealth and extreme hedonism and stuff like that. So really like the ultimate Las Vegas of the entire universe is Naga Loka. So because it's out of sight of the sun, it gets a lot of benefits. So now another important thing here is the Nagas now, they eternally become, henceforth, they become the dire enemy of Indra. Nagas and all the Asuras. Now you know why, don't you? I bet you always knew that the so-called demons are always trying to attack the gods in heaven and occupy paradise. But I bet you didn't know why. Yeah, now you know why, right? Because it's their home. That's their home and they got kicked out of it. And some other punk is sitting on their throne running their homeland and not allowing them back in. They want that back. And even though they built this awesome alternative paradise downstairs, they're not peaceful with the fact that some illegitimate dude is sitting on the throne up there enjoying their space where they're supposed to be. So that's why the Asuras are always trying to kick Indra out so that they can get it back. So now you might have a little sympathy for their situation. And now it may also make sense why great Asura persons like Prahlad Maharaj, Bali Maharaj, who are glorified on the level of any great saint, why they still attack Indra. Prahlad Maharaj, Prahlad attacks Indra. Bali attacks Indra. They all attack Indra because it's a very legitimate battle. All right, any questions? Team Naga. Yeah, actually, we can all relate to the Nagas, right? Let me see if I've got anything here in this. Okay. Here's a little question. Christopher Burns says, hip-hop thieves in the underground. Here's a good question. Daval Dave says, is Aslesha not very compatible with Jeshta? It certainly does not look like Aslesha and Jeshta would get along. However, they are of the very similar nature. Actually, you find this is the truth. People who fight with each other are of a very similar nature. Actually, this is a very interesting point. That you can't really have hatred, like envy, towards somebody who is your superior or your inferior. You really only have struggles with people who are your equals, who are in the same boat as you. The people that are your superiors are the people that could potentially help you. You want to treat them nice. That's your reflexive instance. The people that are your inferiors, they're potentially your followers. They could also potentially help you. Your instinct is to treat them nice too. But the equals are the people you have to fight with all the time. So the fact that the Asuras and Asuras are arch enemies and the Nagas and Indra are arch enemies, it shows that basically they're the same. They're in the same boat. So Jyeshta and Ashlesha actually are similar in many ways in how intensely they possess things and desire things. And also how they deal with underground approaches to things or indirect approaches to things, mystical approaches to things, not blunt and straightforward approaches to getting what they want. But so in people with both Jyeshta and Ashlesha rising, I'm trying to think of two or three clients that I've actually had with those charts. They were really involved in tons and tons and tons of intrigue all the time. And it seems to be a bit of an overkill. All right. All right, let's do this now. Let's keep going. So, the subterranean world of the Nagas is nothing at all like hell or Hades. Now, there is an area that exists which is something like hell or Hades. But that's going to be more associated with Bharani Nakshatra and Yama, who's kind of like the Pluto of the Vedic pantheon, the Vedic archetype of Pluto. Or Hades, is that Hades in Greece? So there is such a thing as these spots, and we'll talk about that when we talk about Bharani, but it's not the Naga's realm, and it's actually not a big, gigantic space. So this, the place of the universe associated with Ashlesha is not at all like hell or Hades. It is a place of grandeur and pleasure, not punishment and lament. And actually, if you read the Puranas, they say that it's more beautiful than the celestial paradise. One of the reasons why it's more beautiful is because there's no sunlight. Now, things can look more beautiful at night because you can notice more of the lights and the colors. There was more iridescence. I don't know if you've ever seen deep ocean photography of the kind of creatures that are down there and how incredibly fascinatingly beautiful they are. So it's the Puranas say that the Naga Lok is actually has superior material pleasures than Swarga. So it's lit up. Yeah, I'm skipping around in my description of it, but the way that it's lit, the way that it's illuminated is very, very fascinating. So it's full of radiant jewels, exotic groves and lights. So it's got a lot of incandescence in the minerals and the jewels and things that they line the spot with. And they decorate themselves also with incandescence and jewels. And now, especially, you know, you always want to say, like, the West Coast girls, like Russian girls, this girls, that girls, right? And that's how people, like, kind of also rate the quality of the country is by the sexiness of the women there. So if you wanted to rate Nagaloka, that's where you find the hottest, hottest, hottest sexy women. And probably all of the sexual arts which are described in the Vedas probably were mastered by the Nagas first. So there's another thing about Ashlesha Nakshatra. It means embrace. So this, it's a very sexual nakshatra. It's a very sexy nakshatra. So they have breathtaking serpentine maidens eager to enjoy their uncommon health and vitality. So they have uncommon health. Why do they have uncommon health in this subterranean place? because they don't have sunrises and sunsets. So therefore, they don't age. They just, their term expires. Their term of life expires. But in between this expiration, they don't get like leathery skin. They don't get dried out by the sun. And they don't get wrinkly and stuff like that because there's no sunlight. Yeah, just a little funny thing. Like, I grew up on Long Island, so my concept of sunlight is like, get in the sun, it'll make you healthy. But now I live in Japan, and like every Japanese woman carries an umbrella at all times. And like always has the umbrella out because they don't want to be in the sun, because the sun ages you. So it depends on, I guess it depends on your melatonin content. You know, Japanese, Asian people have very, very little melatonin content. But I think even if you look at it that way, the melatonin is a protection against the sun. So it is true. The sun is aging us. So they don't age and get wrinkly. The air carries sweet scents and music. The ground is multicolored, soft, and mixed with jewels and gold. Without the sun to mark time in a normal way, the subterranean paradise has exceptional freedom from fatigue. So again, it's like Las Vegas, although I don't know if I could say freedom from fatigue unless you're using some chemical substances. But they do have equivalents of the chemical substances in the subterranean paradise of Ashlesha. This is another thing too. Ashlesha will be pretty amenable to get involved in drugs, alcohol, stuff like that. Because these Nagas, they're doing things to enhance their ability to enjoy life. So people with the Ashlesha Nakshatra will do the same thing. And it depends on the individual, as you would see in an individual chart, which exact way they're going to take to enhance their experience of the sensual world. Some will get really into health. Some will get really into exercise. Some will get really into yoga, mysticism, magic, rituals. Some will get really into drugs. Some will do a little bit of everything. The light here radiates from fantastic phosphorescence and radiant jewels often worn in the crowns of the residents' serpentine hoods. All right, any questions so far? Do Uttarabhadrapada have the same sexual drive? No, now that's very interesting. So why is she mentioning Uttarabhadrapada? Because there's several nakshatras that are Naga. The root Naga nakshatra is this Ashlesha, but also we have the two Bhadrapadas, our special Naga, Anantashesha. But that particular Naga is so different from the other Nagas that that's why he actually left them. Although the Nagas control seven realms, and there's one Naga king for each realm, and Anantashesha was the king of the seventh realm, but he left it because he just wasn't into the Naga way of life. So no, actually, the Naga of the Bhadrapadas, both Bhadrapadas, is still a Naga, but quite different. Everything will be deep and spiritual and everything in the Bhadrapadas, but it's not, it's just a different, it's a very different flavor than it is with Ashlesha. Ashlesha marrying another Ashlesha sounds good. I don't think you have to worry too much about it. It just sounds like it will be naturally easy. I'll check my YouTube thing. Purvapalguni and Ashlesha, the same sexiness. Nothing is the same sexiness, otherwise they wouldn't duplicate it. But everything is, there's a lot of sexy spots in the nakshatras, but they're not the same type of sexiness. Purvapalguni is very adventurous, bold sexiness, a kind of masculine sexiness. Ashlesha sexiness is very, very intoxicating. Do you remember the sutra, the Nakshatra Sutra for Ashlesha? You can go back and check the video for that, and you can also find it in the book that we're reading right now. The Nakshatra Sutra for Ashlesha is Abhyanartyanto Abhyagachanta Prastat Abhyanartyanto Vastat. That's Sarpanam Ashlesha Abhyagachanto Prastat Abhyanartyanto Vastat. So it's talking about hypnotizing. The thing that it does is it hypnotizes and enchants and draws you near, seduces, so that it can make you dance. So the sexiness of Ashlesha is really seductive. And it's very seductive and sultry and mysterious and dark. The sexiness of Purva Palguni is more upfront and male. What about Mrigashirsha and Rohini? Are they Nagas? They're not Nagas at all. Rohini is Ka, the progenitor. And Mrigashirsha is Soma, the moon, the source of nourishment. So these are sexy nakshatras, but they're not. See, Mrigashirsha is a sexy nakshatra because it's so beautiful and timid, and it attracts you so much to pursue it. It's not at all like Ashlesha's sexiness or Purva Palguni's sexiness. Rohini is sexy, kind of like a mid-ground between all of them, actually. Kind of like a jack-of-all-trades sexiness. Just arousing, stimulating, inspiring, and fertile. So all right, so let's get on to the next part. I love April. Her comments are so great going over here on Instagram. Let's see, what do we got? Can you explain Ujjrapad a bit? We'll talk more about Ujjrapad when we get there. Why is it so different? So the thing about Uttara Bhadrapada is it's really not worldly. So whatever sexiness you're going to get in Uttara Bhadrapada is going to be oriented to fantasy, role-playing, thinking, or the symbolic significance of something to something else. It's really not. Uttara Bhadrapada is really not a worldly nakshatra at all. Here's another interesting question. Is in politics, is Ashlesha better than Jyeshtha? Nobody's better than Jyeshtha in politics. Jyeshtha is the supreme, excellent politician. That's why the Nagas are the ones that got kicked out. All right, let's do it. Let's go back to this thing. Yeah, here we go. Now, I remember hearing some of my pals, give their descriptions of nakshatras. And while they would give descriptions of Ashlesha, they would sometimes talk about yoga and spirituality. So here's where this part comes from. Since they dwell below the earthly plane, they are associated with subconscious forces, okay? That's why serpents are associated with scary stuff, stuff that you can't really understand, primal stuff, urges, things like that, stuff that's subconscious below the surface, because they dwell in the Nagaloka, which is literally below the surface. Like lava, which flows within the earth, they are associated with the internal power generators in the organic bodies, aka the chakras. So just like the earth, if you actually drill down into the earth, you get to the mantle. And the mantle is where there's all this magma, right? So, or I guess it's called magma or lava or whatever. So that magma there is like the energy. It's real important to the energy of the earth. It lets the thing, the middle, spin in a different way and make the magnetic field. And it lets all kinds of stuff, heat gets generated out. So similarly, the middle of the earth means like the core of the body. And so the Nagas who dwell and have mastery over this realm where there's this strange power of internal heat, the Nagas are associated with the internal heat sources of the body, the internal energy sources of the body, which we call chakras, because we call them chakra. Chakra means wheel, because they spin energy, just like any wheel. Like, what's that, windmill? The wheel is spinning around the wheel that's in the river to make electricity or grind grain. It spins around to spin things, generates energy. So we got these wheels in our body. Again, we're not talking about things that you could, you know, open up your body and look in and find a wheel spinning around. We're talking about, this is the way, this is the same body that you have, but not seeing it with your human eyes. It has these wheels in it that generate electricity for your body. And the Nagas are associated with it. That's why this whole topic of Kundalini comes from, which is a hugely popular thing in the alternative New Age world, the Kundalini. So Kundalini is basically, Kundalini means just how things, Kundali just means to coil around, spin around. It's the chakra energy spinning around. And what do snakes do? They coil around. So the snakes, the Kundalini, the chakra, it's all about how the energy manifests by coiling around. So Ashlesha people are going to have a lot of interest in generating energy within themselves. And they have a lot of potential to master this Kundalini stuff, which means releasing your own internal energy or harnessing your internal energy and putting it more where you want it instead of just having it build up in the spots where it naturally builds up. So in order to do that, to master Kundalini, you need to do these kind of meditation things and yoga things. And somebody that doesn't know anything about yoga or meditation will look at you and say, wow, you're really spiritual. You're working with your chakras. You're really spiritual. So that word spiritual doesn't actually literally mean not pertaining to material life. It just actually just means you're pretty mystical. So this is an important thing to know about Ashlesha. When people present it as being a very spiritual nakshatra, make sure you realize that the way that they're using the word spiritual is actually just means mystical. Like Aleister Crowley. Aleister Crowley is a very mystical person, but not a very spiritual person. This is the way I'm defining the words. Okay, so that Ashlesha is a lot like Aleister Crowley, but not a lot like Adi Shankaracharya. All right, or Madhvacharya. So in other words, what's the difference between mystical and spiritual? Mystical means using amazing magic and mystic things to eat a better cake. What does spiritual mean? Spiritual means lack of interest in this cake, wanting to get to the root of what that cake really is, to experience it on that level. No longer interested in the form of the cake in and of itself, but it's interested in the essence of what the cake is. But what mysticism is, the way I'm defining it so that you can understand Ashlesha, is I want to eat this cake with my tongue being at the most, you know, potent, having my taste buds at the most powerful so that I can experience, so that when I eat this cake, my head is going to explode with like a taste bud orgasm. So I'm going to do this fast for 6 days, and I'm going to wash my tongue with this kind of mystical salt water and blah, blah. That's the kind of thing that a Shlesha loves to do. Okay, the dragons are... Okay. So do you get it? I kind of presented a little bit out of order. So also the thing about chakras, to understand how sexy Ashlesha Nakshatra really is, the chakra, the lowest chakra is the genitals. It's behind the genitals, in the genitals. It's the place where you're actually generating life force. So that's where the life force is generated. And that's actually what Kundalini Yoga is really supposed to be for, is to harvest that power so that it doesn't just sit down there and make you want to have sex all the time. It's to harvest the power and bring it up someplace else where you can do something else with it, like improve your digestion or improve your emotional connection to other people or improve your power of voice or bring it all the way up and improve your comprehension power. But the root of where the real chakra of all the chakras is down there. And so Ashlesha has to do with sexual energy. Maybe we can transmute this sexual energy into something else, but what in the raw form of Ashlesha is sexual energy. Nagas have to do with sexual energy. The dragons are materialistic. Everybody knows that, right? J.R.R. Tolkien, everybody who ever did any depiction of a dragon, I think, always has them hoarding treasure, right? Dragons are materialistic, fascinated by wealth and pleasure, but their approach to enjoying and acquiring these things is through the exercise of mind-boggling magic powers. Dragons didn't get rich by working at a job. Dragons got rich because they have, like, they can breathe fire and they can fly in the sky and steal everybody's treasure. If the dragons perform some yogic discipline, it is only ever for this sake, for strengthening their ability to enjoy the superior pleasures of this world. Indeed, there is no species who has better mastery over the arts and pleasures of enjoyment. So this is one thing. If you've got an Ashlesha, prominent Ashlesha, you should definitely invest your time and energy into learning arts. Learning arts like dance, music, cooking, anything. Erotic arts, everything. You should learn those things. That'll be very fruitful for you. Because this Ashlesha Nakshatra indicates that your karma in this lifetime is to have a lot of access to those talents. And there's nothing wrong with it. Okay. There are a few dragons, I say in this paragraph. Oh, wait. And I'm going to tell this story. I'll tell this other story quick about the exceptions to this, like, sensual, sexual Naga stereotype. Let me see if we got any one or two comments or questions. Got nothing really good. So then we can go to the next. Does Saturn hurt or make Ashlesha stronger? Saturn and Ashlesha... I have to check my notes. But just remember also that one planet and one nakshatra, it's going to have a range of possibilities. It's only after you know how the whole chart is that you know which part of that range is actually going to be relevant to the person who has that thing. What about Ashlesha Nakshatra Ascendant in the D9? Okay, so this is a mistake which is perpetrated by popular YouTube astrologers that there should be nakshatras different in the subdivisional charts than in the main chart. This is a mistake. I'll just take a time to tell you this, Ava. Nakshatras are stars. They're on the outer layer of the universe. The Rashis are signs. They're in the middle layer of the universe. They're different layers of reality. The amshas, like navamsha, dashamsha, saptamsha, they divide the rashis. The nakshatras are not part of the rashis. They're a separate layer of space. They don't get divided. So don't start thinking, well, my ascendant is at 15 degrees Aries, sidereal Aries in my Navamsha, so that means my sidereal rising sign is Rohini. My Navamsha rising sign is Rohini. Nakshatras are all just out there in space. Can you divide nakshatras? Can you make amshas of nakshatras? Yes, you can. And that's a fascinating thing that is in the oldest text that we have, the Vedanga Jyotish, says that they divide nakshatras up in almost exactly the same way that we currently divide rashis up. We don't do that anymore, except for four. We divide them into four just because of the fact of the coincidence of the size of a nakshatra divided into four is 3 1/3 degrees, and a sign divided into nine is 3 1/3 degrees. So because of that, the four becomes still popular these days. All right. Oh, here's an interesting question from Levi Jesse. What is the technique for a man to bring that kundalini up to the spine? It keeps getting wasted on sexual pursuits and leaves me feeling drained. Would an inversion table help? I don't think an inversion table would help, because you're not dealing with something that responds to gravity. You would want to... you would actually want to deal with an expert in it. As I mentioned in other live sessions, it's not exactly celibacy, but it's you have to have enough sexual activity to keep your lower chakra generating some energy, but you have to have enough abstinence so that you don't spend it all. So probably the best place to start is by some gradually prolonging a period of celibacy, which also means masturbation and all sorts. So you prolong a period of celibacy, start from a couple of days, go up to a couple of months. And then at the same time, you have to concentrate upon the where you want to raise the energy up to. You need to concentrate upon that. So like if you wanted to improve your digestion, the next chakra up, you have to concentrate on the fire in your stomach on a daily basis in a meditation. And that coupled with this initial celibacy will probably do the trick for you. But that's my two cents right here. It would be best if you have a person that actually knows how to do it and knows you. Okay? All right. So let's finish it up. I'll just tell you this last story and then we'll finish up. About the Nagas that didn't go along with Nagas. Shiva, the question here is how you get... Wait, somebody said there's a good question. But I didn't see it. Oh well. How do you relate Ardra with Aslesha? We don't. That was a mistake. Oh, are they related? It's just that Shiva is also one of those persons that's not biased. Who are the gods who are not biased to this polemic that Indra created between Asuras and Suras? That's an interesting thing that we should look at. We already know that Tvashta is one of them, the god of Chitra. Varuna is one of them, the god of Satabhishak. Vishnu is one of them, the god of Shravana and arguably also Shravishta and Dhanishta. Rudra is one of them. And Rudra is the god of Ardra and Mula and the Bhadrapadas. And Brahma is one of them. And Brahma is Abhijit and Rohini. Okay. So these are nakshatras which do not polarize. Okay. So here we go. I'm going to read you this last bit. And then we're going to close. So there are a few dragons who have a different disposition than most of the Nagas. Most of the Nagas have a disposition of, let's enjoy, man. Let's make the most of our life. Let's enjoy the best that we can. But there's some dragons that are a little bit like, huh? So those who do have a different disposition, they actually got estranged from the mass of Nagas. And they themselves kind of made a second exodus. First, we got the exile of the Nagas from Swarga into Bila Swarga, the heaven in a hole, the underground heaven. And then you have an exodus of a couple of important Nagas from the underground heaven to various places. And so this happened around this one incident when the mother of the serpents, Kadru, the mother of the Nagas, once rigged a very serious bet against her own sister, Vinata, because of jealousy and envy. So this is also important to the nature of Aslesha, Nagas, serpents, is it's a lot like Jaisha in this sense. You better watch out for jealousy, envy. There's a lot of possessiveness. I want this. I want to enjoy this. So Aslesha is not really mellow in terms of not getting jealous or envious. It's not really mellow at all, actually. So the mother of the serpents became jealous of her own sister because of the sister's children. So she said to her sister, "Have you seen the beautiful white horse that emerged from the milk ocean when it was churned?" And then her sister Vinata said, "Yes, it was magnificent. I've never seen anything so white." And then Kadru, the serpent mother, says, "No, no, no. It had some black hair." "What? Are you crazy?" "I'm not crazy," Kadru taunted. "You are." Vinata looked at Kadru incredulously. "I will stake my very freedom on it," Kadru said. "If you are right, if the horse has no black hair, I'll be your slave." This is what brothers and sisters say a lot, right? "If you are right, if the horse has no black hair, I'll be your slave, along with all my children, for the rest of our lives." This is a little more intense than the common "I'll be your slave for a day" thing. But if I am right, if the horse does have some black hair, then you and your children will be my slaves for the rest of your lives. If you're so confident, then accept the bet." So Vinata accepted. She didn't know that her sister actually had hatred for her because of Vinata initially having better children than Kadru had. Kadru waited a long time to get children. Kadra then asked her jet-black serpentine children to climb, jet-black serpentine children, to climb into the divine horse's tail, where they could be mistaken for black hair. A small section of her children were so disgusted by this trickery that they disowned their family and moved away from the subterranean paradise. So this is where you get the Naga Anantasesha of Bhadrapada. The rest were quite eager to have Vinata and her two powerful children as their mother's slave, demonstrating the predominant mentality of dragons, which is deceptive, tricky, and prone to act out of envy and jealousy over the treasures and pleasures, assets, and talents possessed by others. This is going to go off on Instagram in like a minute, so see you guys later. We're practically done. With a few rare exceptions for the sake of business and pleasure, the dragon's hatred and spite as a whole is eternally fixed upon Indra. And they, along with the Asuras, disgusted with Indra, who left paradise, are forever bent upon seeking vengeance by reclaiming the heavens and banishing Indra and their gods from their celestial paradise. Okay, great. Let's call it a day. So see you next week at the same time. Next week, what are we going to be doing? Drugs and judges, the new judge, Barney and Yama. So we'll talk about Yama next time. And here we'll hear about hell. All right, guys, thank you for joining me. See you next week at the same time. And I gotta shut everything off. The 55 million things that I got on.